Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
We welcome all who are worshiping with us online or will be later on the radio. And I include that because if you're watching online, we want to make sure that you know that we also have the radio broadcast. And we love to have you listen to us twice or even all throughout the week. Our online availability of worship is open to everyone, so please share that. We have that going on, and it's our outreach here at Good Hope. VBS starts August 1st. More details in the August steeple notes and sign up in the church office. It sounds absolutely wonderful. The decorations on the fence makes me happy every time I drive by the church. I think it's exciting to tell the good story of Jesus Christ. The Emmaus Circle is meeting in the lounge tomorrow at 7 p.m., and all are welcome to join them. And today, our gospel lesson focuses on Jesus feeding the 5,000, something we all are familiar with. If you've been around the church for a long time, it's one of the most well-known stories in the Bible. But it's a reminder, and as we start our worship today, just to think about how important our little part of the world is to the rest of the world. God can do marvelous things with just a little bit of small beginnings. So with that thought, let us stand and prepare our hearts with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life. And feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. We sing, Jesus shall reign.
Jesus shall reign where
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power, riches, wisdom, and strength, and honor, blessing, and glory are His. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And I believe you will be the children today. So. Try your best. What I got here today is something I've used in preschool in the past. It's called The Rabbit Listens by Corey Dorfield. And being I spent a little time with animals this week, goats and cattle and alpacas and whatnot, this book came to mind. But more importantly, it's a good lesson for all of us. So if you bear with me, we will read The Rabbit Listens. One day, Taylor decided to build something. Something new. Something special. Something amazing. Taylor was so proud. Look at the big castle he made. But then, out of nowhere, boom, as you can see, the birds come out of nowhere and knock his castle down. Things came crashing down. The chicken was the first to notice. clock, clock, what a shame. I'm so sorry, sorry, sorry this happened. Let's talk about it. Cluck, cluck, cluck. But Taylor didn't like talking, so the chicken left. Next came the big bear. Rawr, how horrible. I bet you feel so angry. Let's shout about it. Rawr, rawr, rawr. But Taylor didn't like shouting, so the bear left. The elephant knew just what to do. Ta-da-da-da! I can fix this. We just need to remember exactly the way things were. But Taylor didn't like remembering, so the elephant left. One by one they came. The hyena, ha 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 ha, let's laugh about this. The ostrich, gulp, let's hide and pretend nothing happened. The kangaroo, tiss, 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 what a mess. Let's throw it all away. And the snakes, let's go knock down someone else's. But Taylor didn't feel like doing anything with anybody. So eventually, they all left. Until Taylor was alone. In the quiet, Taylor didn't even notice the rabbit. But it moved closer and closer until Taylor could feel its warm body. Together, they sat in silence until Taylor said, "Please stay with me." The rabbit listened. The rabbit listened as Taylor talked. The rabbit listened as Taylor shouted. The rabbit listened as Taylor remembered and laughed. The rabbit listened as Taylor plans to hide, to throw everything away, to ruin things for someone else. Through it all, the rabbit never left. And when the time was right, the rabbit listened to Taylor's plan to build again. "I can't wait," Taylor said. "It's gonna be amazing." See what they're gonna do? But I read this book to you because that is who Jesus is for us. He's always with us. And it isn't that, and as for us, to emulate Jesus, we don't have to be the ones with all the answers, and we don't have to be the ones that are doing anything. The most important thing we can do to each other and with kids and whatever is to be present, just to be with them. So keep that in mind this week, and with that, we are going to pray in silence. Amen. Thank you.
John, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 21. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
My shepherd will supply my need, most holy is his name. In pastures fresh he makes me feed, beside the living stream. He brings my wandering spirit back when I forsake his ways, and leads me for his mercy's sake in paths of truth and grace. When I walk through the shades of death, thy presence is my stay. One word of thy supporting breath drives all my fears away. Thy hand in sight of all my foes doth still my table spread. My cup with blessings overflows, thine oil anoints my head. The sure provisions of my God attend me all my days. O may thy house be mine abode, and all my work be praise. There would I find a settled rest, while others go and come. No more a stranger nor a guest, but like a child at home. no more a stranger nor a guest, but like a child at home. No more a stranger nor a guest, but like a child at home.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, I'm a person that likes to go through those grocery store lines and stand and do all the readings. I've never been bored when I'm in a grocery store because I like those little quick tablets that just have some messages that make you laugh or make you think, what in the world is going on in this world? But sometimes you find hidden treasures. And there was one time about 40 years ago in my teaching that I came across this little story that I even cut out and hung on my bathroom wall for quite a while until it disintegrated. And it goes like this. God looks down at this little child and says, your task is to change the world. And the child looks up to God, so confused and overwhelmed, and said, how can I, one little child, change the world? And God, in all of his wisdom, looks at this child and says, begin by making a better you. I love that story, and I always thought it was a good way to start your day. Begin by making a better you, but there's so much more in the gospel today that tells you how to do it, you know, because sometimes we struggle with that. And the gospel today starts a whole series of readings for the next 5 Sundays from the book of John. 4 of them will be about bread. And so I thought, you know, we are in a world where Netflix is very popular or things like that, Hulu, Amazon, whatever you like to watch, where you binge watch, you know, you see one series and then you can immediately see the next series. I hope we get excited about talking about bread. I hope you start to think, I can't wait till next Sunday to hear more about bread, because it's pretty important stuff and it will change your life. It's so important that this story today, the day's gospel, is in all 4 gospels. That is the only one that's in all 4 gospels. It's important. Matthew has the purpose to make the message to preach the gospel every day. Luke says you should practice the gospel every day. Mark takes the story and says, God will complete the work he has for you, in you. And despite of all of the sins and failures you might have in life, God will make it all work. And here in John, the purpose of this message today is to let you know that Jesus did this all for you. This is the identifying part of Jesus that gives you eternal life. So when you're listening to this story today as I tell it, I want you to imagine you are the characters. You know how you do on your TV shows and your movies, how it becomes part of your life and you constantly think about it, you know? Start thinking about this story as being part of your life. Put yourself in it. Imagine all the characters, because God has taken this story and connected so much of the Bible together. You just can't help but get all involved in the mystery and the suspense and how God is making it all work. It's fascinating. So here we go. Jesus and John is just getting out of the boat. And we have to look at the other Gospels to see what's going on, and this will make more sense to you. A couple of weeks ago, we were talking about Herod having a birthday party. And at that birthday party, his daughter asked for the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And Herod was thinking about that story because he was hearing about Jesus. Meanwhile, Jesus was sending out his 12 disciples two by two, you know, without any money, without any food, just trusting, go, spread the gospel. He gave them all the power and authority to do the healing. So now, here we are, the disciples have returned from that mission, and Jesus has heard. He is on Herod's radar. Herod had killed his cousin, John the Baptist. And we know from the stories in the Bible that Jesus has great emotion. He cried at Lazarus' death. John the Baptist, he was grieving, he was sad. And so his 12 disciples who loved him, they're trying to take care of him. And all these crowds just keep surrounding Jesus, and Jesus needs a little time to get away, so they get him in a boat, and they're going to this remote place, somewhere far away, so Jesus can just have a little bit of time by himself. And as they approach the shore, what do they see? More crowds. But this was way out in the middle of nowhere. The disciples, what would you feel like? Like, we can't get away from all these people. They just keep following us. But this is where Jesus shows us his great love and compassion. He does not think of himself. He gets out of that boat, and he goes right away taking care of the crowds of people, loving them, giving them what they need, and teaching them throughout the day. Well, it's dark. And here comes, it's time for supper. They're hungry. And here comes Philip over to Jesus and said, you know, maybe you should stop teaching so these people can go get something to eat. And this is where we pick it up. Can't you imagine Jesus? He's so happy. Finally, they are catching on. They saw a need. He was so happy that Philip came to him with this problem, that he saw people that needed something to eat. Philip wasn't thinking about himself, he was thinking of the other people. And so Jesus, I believe, has this wonderful sense of humor and also some ways of teaching that I just find fascinating. He asks a question. Well, where can we go buy bread? Now, can you imagine Philip hearing that from Jesus? Where can we go buy bread? We're out in the wilderness, Jesus. There's nothing around. What are you thinking? But Jesus knows exactly what he's thinking. He's testing Philip. And he doesn't give him the answer. He makes him try to figure it out. And so Philip is thinking worldly, and he goes, well, I think, you know, it would take 6 months' wages to feed all of these people. And that's impossible. But Andrew starts to look around to see what's right in front of him, what he had learned when he was out on that mission, when Jesus had sent them out to do the job that he asked them to do. Andrew looks around and he sees this one small boy. He has a basket, he has 5 loaves of barley bread and 2 fish. And that's what he says. And I would think Jesus would make him wait just a little bit before he would respond. But that's exactly what Jesus was waiting for. People to look around and think, what are we going to do? So Jesus takes over and he goes, you tell the crowds to sit down. And that's very significant. When Jesus would teach, in that day and time when a teacher would teach, the people that they were trying to teach would sit down. And so this is a signal. There's a teaching moment coming up. Have the crowds sit down. And they're in this big grassy field. You know, that. Why did John put that in there? There was a lot of grass. Well, because John wanted you to know they are in the wilderness. There is nothing around them. And this should start feeding into your minds. I'm not going to tell you what it is yet, but where else was there a feeding in the wilderness? Keep thinking back to what you have learned before. And Jesus takes the loaves of barley bread. Barley bread is said because that is the poorest grain that can make bread. There's really good bread, and then there's barley bread. That's what the poorest of poor ate. And Jesus took this barley bread. He gave thanks. And then he gave it to the people to be distributed to all, to eat for all. Well, this sounds a little familiar, right? And then he said, well, collect all the extra because there's going to be an abundance. And so he does. There's 12 baskets. And of course, 12 is a big number in the Bible. 12 tribes of Israel, 12 disciples, 12 baskets of abundance. It's significant. Everything in this story has a message that makes you want to dig deeper. Some people have speculated that maybe that little boy received that extra 12 baskets. From giving everything he had, he received an abundance. We don't know. These are just imaginations, but that's what makes it so beautiful. That's what John plants in us, that curiosity to wonder what happened here to all the people. The discipleship was shown. Jesus is teaching us how to teach others, how to share the good news. But Jesus is always in control. Well, here are the crowds. They just have been fed everything they want. And what do? They want more food. This is what it is all about. They want the Messiah. They want Jesus to be the king so they never are hungry again. And they want to take Jesus by force. Well, that is not God's plan. So Jesus has to retreat. He does not want to be their king on earth. His kingdom is much greater, but they can't see it yet because they're just thinking about themselves. So finally, Jesus goes up to the mountaintop and prays by himself. The disciples leave on a boat across the sea. And you see, this is why that little tail end is put into the gospel today, because this is significant. The sea is always, in the Bible, a time of chaos. And I think that's the message today. Our life is always in chaos. There is chaos in the world always because there is sin and it's broken. And what did the disciples know about Jesus? Well, they knew that he did miracles and they knew that he healed people. They had seen the signs that John had planted, so many in front of them. But did they know who Jesus was yet? Jesus goes to the mountaintop and prays to his Father. That is an example we are to know. And then he looks out on that chaotic sea, and he starts to walk to them. And we know the story of Jesus walking on the water. But did Jesus intend to get into the boat, or was he trying to show them his identity? Because it all goes back. It's a story that tells you about Moses in Exodus, right? It's linked in. It tied together. So the Jewish people should have been picking this up. Jesus in Exodus fed those people that were walking in the wilderness with the bread from heaven, the manna. Right in front of all the disciples in the crowd is the bread from heaven, Jesus himself. Exodus 34 tells us that Moses asked God, he goes, I want to see you. Nobody had ever seen God's face. And remember, God said, I'll put you in that cleft of the cave. And he walked by him. But Moses almost missed him and only saw his back. In Job 9, sometimes we can't even perceive Jesus walking right by us. The perception of who Jesus is what is going to be the message here as Jesus is walking by that boat. But what does Jesus see? He knows us so well. He knows we need him. And those disciples were scared. They thought they were going to overturn in that boat. And Jesus said, "Don't be afraid, it is I." And he gets in the boat and he calms the sea. You see, that's the message of today. God is always with us. We have to look for it. We have to be willing to trust it. The Lord's Supper, the Passover feast, is told right here. How Jesus came to us, was broken, hung on a cross for us, so that we all could partake of the nourishment of life that keeps us close to Jesus Christ, to keep our hearts open so that we can see the world and share the good news always by first seeing the need and then trying to figure out what we do. And knowing that even if we are just a small person, that we might feel insignificant in this world, that Jesus takes all of the little bits of our life, those small beginnings, and when we give it to God, just like that little boy who changed the world that day, gave everything he had, "Here's my 5 loaves of barley and 2 fish. Take it." And Jesus took it and blessed it for abundance. What a beautiful story. What a great gospel lesson that should make you excited to hear more and more about the bread of life, because it is the good news that in the chaotic sea that we live in, Jesus is there with us, always. You are worthy. You are not insignificant. In September, we are starting A New Beginnings. And I'm asking you to start praying today of what you have to offer, what you can do. And we are going to do great things through Christ, because that is what God has called us to do. Amen.
Praise and thanksgiving, God.
Let us now confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all creation. We pray for the church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations. Empower churches throughout the world, encouraging missionaries who accompany global neighbors. Kindle in us the spirit of collaboration, that all people may know your loving works. Hear us, O God. We pray for all creation. Send rain to the lands experiencing drought, and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nurture wheat and barley crops grown for the nourishment of your people. May all your wonderful creation flourish for all time. Hear us, O God. We pray for those who govern. Cast out arrogance, selfishness, and corruption, and the thirst for power. Instruct those who lead to practice compassion and humility. Inspire them with the vision of the common good and the commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. Hear us, O God. We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve and hear the cries of those who call to you for healing, especially Mary Addison, Miriam Everts, Mary Ann McAllister, Melody Reed, Rick Schnabel, Heidi Walton, Violet Wingate, Ruth Vaughn, Keith Young. We also pray for the many prayers that have been answered. Today we celebrate with thanksgiving the birth of Hunter Allen Gill, son of Tyler and Leslie Gill. May his life be filled with your blessings. We also give thanks and praise for Rick Schnabel and his successful six-hour surgery. May he experience a quick and thorough recovery. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for this assembly. Deepen our resolve to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us by your abundance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray with thanksgiving that through the Holy Spirit, we all carry the tools of faith, love, and compassion, equipping us to tell the good news of Jesus Christ to our neighbors near and far. Strengthen our hearts to be the engine of change for our troubled world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for those who have died. As you sustain them through all their days, so dwell in our hearts that we may have the power to comprehend, with the Apostle James and all the saints, the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. Today we graciously lift up the life of Virginia Knight. As you wrap her in your loving arms for all eternity, comfort those who miss her most, for she has won life's battle, and now she has found peace. Hear us, O God. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Share the peace of the Lord. Let us stand for the prayer. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. You may be seated. I read this to tell you what we believe as we come to the table. Christ comes to us in the real presence, in, with, and under the bread and wine, to nourish the faith of Christians and the church. The invitation of this sacred meal that spans all time and space welcomes all believers. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come.
Lamb of God. Thank you.
And if you feel comfortable holding someone's hand next to you, please do so. May the body and blood strengthen and keep your hearts in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. At this time, I ask for the ministers who distribute our home communion to our shut-ins to please come forward at this time to receive your kits. This is a beautiful ministry that we are so happy that we have a very active group of people that come and do this and extend the table. The communion table is made wider. God blesses us and sends us into mission to the world. God's mission includes the gifts of grace that we share in worship and also to take to the absent. Now we are sent to continue and participate in God's mission with the blessing of God. We go out to live as Christ's body in the world. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Amen. On our way rejoicing, we sing.
Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.